I'm in a lake that is so salty that not even fish can live in it. So salty that I can float without even trying. This is one of the most important tourist destinations in North America. And here come the tourists now. Utah's Great Salt Lake, the largest salt lake in the Western Hemisphere, is a vital ecosystem for many different kinds of wildlife, like more than 10 million birds. About 300 different species are found here. Some stay full-time, but many, many more pass through on an annual journey or migration from their winter homes in Central and South America to nesting and feeding grounds as far north as the Arctic. From songbirds to raptors, they travel along the Pacific Flyway, one of four major migration routes through North America. And for many, especially shorebirds and waterfowl, the most important stop by far is the Great Salt Lake. But this amazing place is facing some big challenges, and it needs our help to survive. Even though the area around the Great Salt Lake is dry, a lot of snow falls on the surrounding mountains. Every spring, it melts into streams that flow into three major rivers and then to the lake. And that's where the water stops, because unlike most lakes, the Great Salt Lake is a terminal lake, meaning no rivers or streams flow out of it. So with all of this fresh water flowing in, why is the lake still so salty? We're gonna do a little experiment to find out.
So we're here with these two containers of water that replicate the conditions at Great Salt Lake. We're gonna go ahead and put salt into each container, an equal amount. And what we're gonna do with these containers is, one, we're gonna put away into the shade and leave it there. Okay. The other, we're going to put out in the sun.
All right, so we are back with students from Mountain View Elementary School from Layton, Utah.
Okay, we have two containers of water with salt in them, and one of them we've left out in the sun for a few days.
And we're going to do a taste test to see if there's a difference in the saltiness of each one. So go ahead and take your finger, one finger. Let's taste it.
It's barely salty.
Very, barely salty.
No, I don't taste any salt.
Barely.
Now go ahead and one finger.
Oh, that's good.
That's a lot of salt.
That's tasty. In the real world, streams pick up salt from rocks and soil and carry it to the lake. In the hot sun and dry air, water evaporates very quickly. But salt, as a mineral, is left behind. So as water levels go down, salinity goes up. The Great Salt Lake varies between 5% and 27% salinity. That's 3 to 9 times as salty as the ocean. Besides regular salt, the lake's water is high in minerals like potassium compounds and magnesium. None of this makes it sound like a very welcoming place for birds. But in fact, they can find all of the elements they need. Protection, shelter, and food? To understand how anything can survive the extreme environment of the Great Salt Lake, we need to look at the bottom of the food chain. Billions of years ago, bacteria and algae were some of the first organisms to make oxygen. Sometimes, they grouped together in mats around which minerals formed. These weird structures are called microbialites. And today, this is one of the few places on Earth they are still found. Shockingly, these unassuming formations are necessary for the survival of two creatures that feed millions of birds: brine shrimp and brine flies. Brine flies have a weird and wonderful life cycle. They start as eggs, which hatch into swimming, algae-eating larvae. When ready, they find a spot on the bottom of the lake, usually on a microbial light mound, and make a pupal case like a cocoon. When they hatch, they do something even cooler. They make an air bubble to float to the surface.
Brine shrimp, on the other hand, spend their entire lives in water. You may have seen them advertised as sea monkeys, which you can grow and keep as pets.
But they're not just cute. Brine shrimp are super tough.
They're so cool because they're adapted to live in some of the harshest climates on Earth. The fact that they can survive where so few things can. The brine shrimp eggs, you could freeze them, you can boil them, you can send them to outer space, you can bury them for 1,000 years, and you put them in salt water, and some of them will still hatch.
That's super
cool. Like, how amazing is that?
That's really amazing.
Brine shrimp can live for about 4.5 months. Adult brine flies only live a few days. Hungry birds eat a lot of brine shrimp and brine flies, and they have amazing methods to do that. Gulls simply open their mouths wide and run through clouds of brine flies. Snowy plovers run along the shore and pick them up one by one. American avocets wade through the water, sweeping their curved bills back and forth to filter out brine shrimp. Black-necked stilts eat both brine shrimp and flies. Goldeneye eat brine fly larvae off the bottom of the lake in the dead of winter. Phalaropes eat the brine flies off the surface of the water. And they have an even more incredible feeding method. They spin, creating a whirlpool that draws brine shrimp and fly larvae up from the bottom, and then enjoy their meal. The lake is also a wonderful shelter. Some birds depend on the open water to protect them. Every year, 1.7 million eared grebes shelter on the water while molting. Predators are rare, and they have access to the food they need to grow new feathers. Others rely on the shoreland, especially the wetlands. These areas around the edge of the lake are important. For birds like white-faced ibis that eat small freshwater creatures, this is the only place in the lake they can find the food they need. Birds like grebes, coots, and ducks nest in wetlands around the lake, hidden in the grass and reeds and protected by water and sticky mud. So now that we know how special this place is, imagine what would happen if it went away. Over the last few decades, the lake has shrunk by almost half its size. And as that happens, it gets even saltier. One of the causes is climate change. Historically, snow here in the mountains has lasted well into spring. But in recent years, there's been less snow and has been melting earlier. But the biggest issue is that too much of that snowmelt is being used before it even hits the lake. Over half of Utah's growing population lives within 20 miles of the lake, and there is an increased demand for water. So, less water, more salt, that can't be good.
High salinities threaten brine shrimp because as good as they are at surviving in these really tough environments, even they have their limit. And so when the water gets to about 19 or 20% salinity, it just becomes too much for them and the population crashes.
Brine flies and the microbialites they depend on also have an upper limit. And microbialites exposed to the sun by the shrinking lake can die in just a few days. What would happen if they all disappeared?
There's a couple of impacts that we would see immediately. One is for certain species of birds, Wilson's phalaropes and eared grebes, I mean, this is like their only refueling station. So if you lose the brine shrimp, the birds are going to show up and they won't have anything to eat.
And what about if wetlands dried out? Without their shelter, eggs and birds could become food for predators like foxes and raccoons. There would even be impacts to the local economy and our worldwide food supply.
We harvest those little baby brine shrimp eggs by the trillions, and they're used as feed for baby shrimp and fish. So it really plays an important role in helping feed the world, these little tiny brine shrimp from the Great Salt Lake.
So it's urgent that we take steps to protect this extreme habitat. It's as simple as using less water. If all of us, food producers, factories, mines, cities, and neighbors start conserving more water, there will be that much more for the lake. The state government has quickly mobilized a big response to encourage just that. Along with more water in the lake, the wetlands around the lake need attention too. The Nature Conservancy has helped protect and restore this precious habitat, including at TNC's Great Salt Lake Shorelands Preserve, and has big plans for the future. Scientists from our partner groups are closely studying the habits of migrating birds through tagging and other projects. And sharing this awesome place with other people is also part of the solution.
Listen, listen, do you hear? I hear a sandhill crane. Do you see him? This is a bird that's as tall as you.
Long legs.
Oh, really so long pretty. Legs. They're so
that's
pretty.
Really pretty.
The Great Salt Lake is so much more than a lake. It's a crucial ecosystem that is connected to so many aspects of wildlife and human life. And it's up to us to help protect it.
I've worked with Great Salt Lake for a while now, and I've really seen a shift in the way people think about the lake. And that gives me hope that we can, you know, kind of change our minds and decide that a place is beautiful and worth protecting.
Why would people want to come together and protect a place like this?
So we can protect the ecosystem and other people can enjoy this place.
Yes, absolutely.
There are ways you can help even if you don't live nearby. Reduce how much water you use and talk to your family about using less water. Plant a garden, a tree, anything. They help keep water in the soil, which is good for your community, your local lakes, birds, and wildlife. And if you want to do even more, look up your local elected officials and write them a letter to express how much you love water and wildlife. And keep learning. You could be part of finding a solution to the problems facing the Great Salt Lake.